Well, let's bow our hearts and head before God today in prayer. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, as I stand behind this holy desk, I declare today that your will be done. Help me to speak accurately and correctly. Help me to speak on your behalf, Lord. Help your people today have eyes to see and ears to hear. For you are good, and your mercy does endure forever. We thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit that destroys every yoke. We thank you that fear will depart and faith will be imparted. And we give you praise and give you glory as the saints arise for a call to action today to be doers of the word and not hearers only. And we thank you for a world that awaits us to be changed in the presence and by the glory of God. And for this, we give you the praise and give you the glory for it all in Jesus' wonderful and almighty name. And all the saints that agree with that said, amen. Praise God. Well, most of you know that we began a new series. I've just done a couple messages. We had a few interruptions with other things going on. Amen. But this new series called The Great Reset. Amen. And we began by talking about God's Great Reset. Now, I want you to listen very carefully to me today because I'm going to recap really quick about some very important things that you need to remember about God's Great Reset. The very first thing that we talked about in the Great Reset was God's Great Reset. That is what is most important. And what I want to do is to remind us five things today that it implied or that it's incorporated in God's Great Reset that we've looked at thus far. I'll do this quickly, but it's very important that we remember these things and we know these things like we know our name. Amen. And God's Great Reset, God gives us His Word to, number one, reset the direction of our lives. Reset the direction of our lives. We found out from the scripture that in God's Great Reset, God gave us His Word to reset the direction of our lives. We were all going our own way, doing our own thing. Amen. And God, by His Word, got a hold of us. Amen. And His Word resets the direction of our life. Number two, in God's Great Reset, God gives us His Word to empower and strengthen us to take the right direction. To take the right direction. God always empowers and strengthens us to take the right direction through His Word. In other words, God's Great Reset brings us to Him and into His plan for our lives. That's what's important. The third thing we talked about is in God's Great Reset, God gives us His Word to deliver us from this present evil world, sin and Satan. God gives us His Word to deliver us from this present evil world, from sin, and from Satan. Amen. The fourth thing that we found out in God's Great Reset, God gives us His Word to make us His children, His sons and daughters of God. Amen. How many sons and daughters we got in here today? I want to remind you, that's a great privilege to be a son and daughter of God. Now, the fifth one is where I want to take about 5 minutes and just park on just really quick. But it's going to be imperative that you know this, you think about this, and everything else that we talk about today, you have reflected back into your mind this fifth point that we've talked about already. In God's Great Reset, God gives us His Word to make us new creations or new creatures in Christ Jesus. God gives us His Word to make us new creatures or new creations in Christ Jesus. Now, I know you know the scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. You can just write that down. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. This is imperative that we understand a number of points here, and none any important than this. New, this word new means new in kind and and new in quality. It means a new kind of person. That means that when we were born again, when we made Jesus Christ the Lord of our life, we became a brand new kind of person. Amen. Jesus Christ, listen to this statement. I've made it many times in this church, but I realize that just because you've heard it doesn't mean you got it. Jesus Christ came to create a new race of human beings in whom God could dwell and through whom God could work. I'm going to say it again. Jesus Christ came to create a new race of human beings in whom God could dwell and through whom God could work. Amen. Notice a new race of human beings. Have you forgot what 1 Peter, just write it down, they won't put this up, what 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9 says. It calls us a chosen, but you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. For you've been called out of darkness into His marvelous light to show forth the glorious praises of our God. That's what a new race of human being is. But listen, it's a spiritual race. Everybody say a spiritual race. It's a spiritual being, a brand new being that never existed before. It's not based, this race, it's not this new race of human beings is not based upon color, nationality, gender, or culture. Because it's one in Christ. And here's the good news. God invites the whole world into it. God invites the whole world into it. Now what I want us to do is look at two verses of Scripture. The first beginning in Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. Turn there with me if you would. I'm going to actually be reading this from the Passion Translation. Passion Translation, Galatians 3, 26 through 29. Here's what it says. I want you to remember, Jesus Christ came to create a new race of human beings in whom God could dwell and through whom God could work. Remember, this new race is a spiritual race. Hallelujah. It's not based upon color, nationality, gender, or culture. It's something the world ain't never seen before. But God designed this. This is part of God's great reset to make us as we originally were created in His likeness, in His image, and now make us Christ-like, make us brand new with His very life and nature living in through us. And He invites the whole world. That's why God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever will believe on Him will not perish but have everlasting life. Notice in Galatians 3 verse 26 through 29. Let me read it to you from the Passion Translation. It says, you have all become true children of God by faith in Jesus, the Anointed One. First of all, we're not all children of God. We are all children of God through faith in Jesus Christ. We're all born part of the human race, but we're not all children of God except through our faith in Jesus Christ. Our faith in Jesus Christ makes us children of God. Notice that's what the Scripture teaches us. It was faith that immersed you into Jesus and the Anointed One. And now you are covered and clothed with His anointing. We no longer see each other in our former state, Jew or non-Jew. Come on, rich or poor. The footnote says that, enslaved or free. Come on. Male or female, we see no longer male or female, because we're all one through our union with Jesus Christ, with no distinction between us. See, this is the equality that God set up in His Word. This is true biblical equality. And a world that's calling out for equality, it's calling out for something that many times is not what even God calls equality. But God has made a way that it makes us all on the same playing field, because we become new through becoming children of God and through faith in Jesus Christ. Come on, can I get an amen in here today? This is true equality. It goes on and says, and since you've been united to Jesus, the Messiah, we are now Abraham's children and inherit all the promises of the kingdom realm. Jesus Christ came so that there would be true equality of all mankind. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Now, let's look at Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, and we want to look at verse 10 and 11, because this is talking about, once again, the great reset that God has for His people to create a new race of human beings that never existed before. Hallelujah. Glory to God, and through whom God could live and through whom God could work. In verse 10, it says, You have acquired a new creation life, which is continually being renewed in the likeness of the one who created you, giving you the full revelation of God. In this new creation life, your nationality makes no difference. Yeah, and that means that whatever nation of birth that you're in makes no difference. Your ethnicity, however you say that word, amen. That means, that was pretty close. That's race, culture, hallelujah, or color. That's what it means. Race, culture, or color, education, or economic status, they matter nothing. They matter nothing. It all gets swallowed up in Christ. For it is Christ that means everything, as He lives in every one of us. Woo! Hallelujah. See, in a world today that's crying out for equality, crying out for all kind of things, you can tell whether they're barking up the right tree or not. If they leave out Jesus and His equation, they're talking about something that really is not the equality the Bible's talking about. The Bible talks about equality, and Jesus makes us all equal and one new man. Woo! Glory to God. So we should all believe in equality. That we all have certain inalienable rights, in other words, God-given rights that no one should take away from us. Hallelujah. But let's make sure that we funnel everything through the Word of God. Because what we find is this, that God's great reset only comes through Jesus Christ. And what we just talked about is God's great reset and God's plan for all of humanity to make a new race of human beings in whom God could dwell and through whom God could work. Once again, it's not based upon color, nationality, gender, or culture. It simply changes us through our faith in Jesus Christ and makes us one new man in Jesus Christ, where there's not Jew nor Gentile, but the one new man in Jesus Christ. See, everything else is just blowing smoke, church. And you can tell even when church folk get all confused about all kind of things. But I can tell you, we don't have to be confused. This is why I'm talking about it today. Because this is the great reset that God called for us to be. Then what we talked about, once again, it only comes through Jesus Christ. Then what we talked about was that there's counterfeits and how Satan is a counterfeiter. We spent one whole lesson about this. That means this. If he's a counterfeiter, it means that he has a reset as well. Now, I introduced this thought, but today I want to delve into this, because this is important so that we as the church are not just informed, but we understand what God says, what He doesn't say, and that we walk with God and we're not confused like the world is confused. Amen. So it means that when we talked about counterfeits and Satan is a counterfeit, it means he has a reset too. See, God is the creator and the originator. Satan is a counterfeiter. He's a counterfeiter. Amen. So you probably guessed it. Satan's reset works to keep mankind from ever coming to Jesus Christ. Come on, did you hear me? It opposes God's great reset with His own reset. Satan reset takes you away from all that is of God and Jesus Christ and brings you into a satanic plan for your life. Now see, many times, you know, before you made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, you had no idea that you were following the whims of the world and the flesh and of the devil. But the scripture clearly makes that clear to us. Ephesians chapter 2 verses 1 through 5 makes us very clear. Before we made Jesus Christ the Lord of our life, we were blinded, we were led about. Hallelujah, by the whims of the world and by the prince of the power of the air, who was the Lord of our life unknowingly. Even though Satan's great reset is camouflaged to the world, the discerning believer can clearly see it for what it really is by its anti-God and anti-Christ agendas. Come on. It should be clearly seen to the church. Even though the Satan's great reset, it be camouflaged to the world. It means it's disguised. It's made to look right. It's hidden. It's all its agendas are hidden. But it shouldn't be hidden to the church. Any anti-God and anti-Christ agendas, listen, are you listening to me? Any of those should be a red flag to the church that this opposes God. So today's message I want to entitle The Great Reset Unmasked. The Great Reset Unmasked. So I'm going to warn us today. Sometimes before you watch a television show, it comes up, warning. Amen. Today I do have a warning. The contents of much of what you're about to see and hear are disturbing. However, this is not to produce fear, but a call to action for every saint. I'm going to say it again. This is not to produce fear. Even though the things I'm going to be sharing and through much of this you hear and see are going to be disturbing, I am saying it is not to produce fear. I am saying it is to produce a call to action for every believer. And I'll show you how to do it before it's over with today. Amen. Are you ready? Well, we're going to put a slide up here that was from a recent Time magazine cover. And notice, it said The Great Reset by Klaus Schwab. Amen. Now, in this was the cover of the Time magazine. And it's very important that you understand this in October 2020. This magazine came out before the election. The reason I'm saying this is because there's going to be some things I show you in just a moment that is going to make more sense, because you can see this article what came out before the election and the things that pertain to it. But Time magazine, in October the 30th of 2020, released this article called The Great Reset. Notice Time magazine, this was their feature article and their cover. And here's what it said. It says, Time magazine announces The Great Reset to usher in world socialism. To usher in world socialism. Now, first of all, I want us to understand this. If we do any kind of really research, we find that socialism has never worked anywhere it's ever been. It is attempted. It has held people in bondage and captivity. It still does today, but it never works. Amen. In October 30th, 2020, Time magazine has devoted, let me read a couple things to you that what I'm going to do is just take a brief takeaway from the article that Time magazine did. Time magazine has devoted an entire issue to promoting the initiative called The Great Reset. They call it that. Referred to by one of the commentators as the New Green Deal on steroids, which will seek to advance socialistic ideals, including the destruction of capitalism and individual rights. Now notice, in other words, I want us to be reminded today that socialism, three of the main points of socialism is, one, the abolition of all personal property. That secondly, the abolition of all religion. The abolition, thirdly, of, praise God. It's something else. Praise God. Amen. Well, amen, of the Judeo-Christian family. Amen. And so, we must understand that this is no laughing matter. According to the World Economic Forum, the primary sponsor of the initiative, and this is why, you know, Klaus Schwab, who is the president, which you'll find in just one moment, of the World Economic Forum, he has been that since 1971. Okay, so we know this, that the Great Reset seeks to address an urgent need for global stakeholders to cooperate in simultaneously managing the direct consequences of the COVID-19 crisis, with an expected goal of improving the state of the world. The World Economic Forum was founded by German professor Klaus Schwab and has been gathering heads of states, billionaires, and billionaire philanthropists like George Soros and Bill Gates, and heads of big business, big tech, big pharma, and big finance yearly to discuss economical and governance issues. In other words, common world rules to supersede national sovereign decisions, promoting non-discrimination to transform economies and societies. That's a big long word that just says it's socialism up to you till you drowned in it. It takes away all your rights, and it takes away national rights to be superseded by others that know more than you and I. The subtitle for the time feature proposed a special occasion for the present moment for such an initiative, asserting the COVID-19 pandemic has provided a unique opportunity to think about the kind of future we want, to share ideas of how to transform the way we live and work, thus entering in all the lockdowns, thus entering in all the restrictions, all in the name for the betterment of everyone. We goes on and it says in the article, Schwab announces the COVID-19 crisis has shown us that our old systems are not fit anymore for the 21st century. It has laid bare the fundamental lack of social cohesion, fairness, inclusion, and equality. Now is the historical moment, the time, and not only to fight the virus, but to shape the system for the post-COVID era. In short, we need a great reset. He also asserts that the world must act jointly and swiftly to revamp all aspects of societies and economies, from education to social contracts and working conditions. Thus, we have entered into America just a few things that we should be aware of, like the Equality Act and critical race theory. These are things that are being pushed in our country today based upon what the World Economic Forum and the Great Reset is pushing. Every country, he goes on to say, from United States to China must participate. And every, good luck with China. But that's what he says. Every country from the United States. And see, the reason why he says the United States is because the United States is the last hurdle. The United States is the last hurdle and the great obstacle to the great reset in the world. Because that freedom is what opposes, and truth and absolute morals oppose this very thing. He says every country from the United States to China must participate, and every industry from oil to gas to tech must be transformed. Now, I guess that's why there's a cancel culture now. In short, we need a great reset of capitalism. In other words, only the rich have anything else, and you have nothing, and you will enjoy it. That's what he actually said. Okay, now, so in other words, this is about a reset of everything. The Great Reset then politically and economically wants to implement massive social programs. Amen. And then while this article says this, and while the Great Reset have yet to be revealed, in other words, because it's expected to disclose other details at the World Economic Forum meeting in January of 2021. This writer says, however, given the evidence, Justin Haskins of the Heartland Institute concludes, it's clear that the purpose of the plan is to move the world economy towards socialism using climate change and COVID-19 as justification. That's a tough pill to swallow, church, but it's absolutely the truth. Now, I want you to watch this short but informative video that we have for you now concerning this very article.
Here's a video of your future. If some people at the World Economic Forum get their way, they say you'll own nothing and be happy about it. energy will be green, rationed, and expensive, and travel will be restricted. Even your diet will be controlled, and currency will be digital. This left-wing dystopian dream is called the Great Reset, and you're supposed to be excited about it. The Great Reset has been labeled a conspiracy theory, and even sounds like a conspiracy theory. But everything we know about it comes from the global elites themselves, who have been quite open about it.
This is not a conspiracy theory. This is a well-documented movement among many of the world's most powerful people.
Justin Haskins is a leading authority on the Great Reset.
Fundamentally, this is a radical and complete transformation of everything that we do in our society to control people's behaviors, to control businesses, and to move society in the direction that you want to move it. It will change the way businesses are evaluated. It'll coerce businesses to pursue left-wing causes.
The Great Reset was unveiled at the World Economic Forum in Davos, Switzerland, where many of the world's most powerful people go to offer solutions to the world's problems. And the World Economic Forum sees the coronavirus pandemic as a historic opportunity to change the way the world operates.
Right now we're facing a crisis of international proportion. It's going to have long-term impact for us.
Their solution is essentially global socialism. Think of the Green New Deal combined with the COVID-19 lockdown restrictions, and throw in something called the Fourth Industrial Revolution, in which technology is supposed to radically change the way we live and work. Klaus Schwab is the founder of the World Economic Forum.
What the Fourth Industrial Revolution will lead to is a fusion of our physical, our digital, and our biological identities.
It has the support not only of world leaders, but of global corporations like MasterCard and BP, brought to you by people who think they know what's best for you.
By giving, you know, the elites, the technocrats in society, the most educated people, the ability to manipulate society, pull the levers in society, and manage and manipulate society so that it's, in their minds, perfect.
But a Trump re-election would blow a massive hole in the Great Reset. 1 week before the election, Italian Archbishop Carlo Maria Vigano wrote an open letter to the president, warning him that the Great Reset is inhuman, faceless tyranny that seeks to subdue all of humanity, and that President Trump and the United States are the wall against the deep state, the final assault of the children of darkness.
Over the past 4 years, Donald Trump has been the single greatest roadblock for people who are pushing this internationalist, globalist sort of agenda.
The elites at Davos are now counting on a Biden victory for their Great Reset to go forward. The World Economic Forum and the Biden campaign even share the same slogan, Build Back Better.
To build back better.
It's also a phrase you've heard being used by Justin Trudeau, by the Pope, by the Prince of Wales, and by leaders around the world.
English journalist and author James Dellingpole.
You'd be amazed by how many world leaders are on board with this globalist plan, even people that claim to be conservative. This is worse than Nazism. This is worse than communism. This is worse than fascism. These guys are planning on taking over the whole world.
We'll hear more about the Great Reset when the World Economic Forum meets again in January. And whether he's in the White House or not, Donald Trump is expected to be a force, which could remain a problem for the hopeful backers of the Great Reset. Dale Hurd, CBN News. This is
sobering. Now, what I want to do next is further unmask the Great Reset, and the unmasking is something that is called transhumanism. Transhumanism. The fusion of human beings with technology in an attempt to alter human nature itself and create a superhuman being and an earthly paradise. One of the things that as we're going to talk about at the next few moments about transhumanism, it's very important that you understand They want to make a super race. Counterfeit. 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 And one of the things that we don't have time to talk about today in all of this great reset is that they have a problem. It's called you and I. You ever heard of carbon footprint? That just means that we take up space and we breathe and we're polluting the earth. So the problem is that we have, I'm doing this really quick, there must be a way to depopulate the earth because we are currently almost 8 billion people, and their proposal is to make this utopia or this super race, this super being, but also a earthly paradise that we're going to talk about in just one moment briefly. But it's going to take us from going to about 8 billion people to down to 500 million. Guess who they choose to be part of the depopulation? Okay. So transhumanists propose to use technology. Let's talk about this one moment. Propose to use technology. Now, the good news is coming, church. Okay. This is pretty sobering right now, but this is the world that we live in. So wake up. Transhumanists propose the use of technology to alter human nature, to produce human beings with super longevity, super intelligence, and super well-being. Listen, we can't even give they can't even create a vaccine that protects us. Come on. Now, they're going to do something. That's their going to be attempt. I'm going to believe we're going to be out of here when it happens. This transhumanist agenda will require the concentration of political and economic power in the hands of the global elite and the dependence of people on the state. What is that called? World socialism. See, people rather be taken care of. I have a real concern today. People rather be taken care of than have liberty and have freedom. Just take care of me and I'll do whatever you say. Give me another stimulus check. So I'll stay home. I'll do whatever. Now, I want people to be taken care of, but not at the cost of their freedom. Come on. To sell the Great Reset, the global elite twist the language and disguise their transhumanistic agenda behind phrases. So it's sold to us as an idea that's not necessarily going to affect us. Or that it's progress that will benefit humanity. Just like Hitler says, this is for the betterment of all the people. The plan is satanic through and through. In the World Economic Forum, when they met and these things came out, you found out this transhumanist enmity with Christianity becomes apparent. I'm going to say that again. Transhumanist enmity, that means hatred, with Christianity becomes apparent. They reject the Christian belief in absolute truth. And that God created human beings in His image and likeness and sees absolute values in the Christian faith as a break for their pretensions of transhumanist and globalist progressivism. Transhumanism is genetic modification and the merging of AI and artificial intelligence and human beings to make a super race. With this, we're looking at the destruction of human beings as we know it and a creation of hybrid beings. Part of the Great Reset's agenda is transhumanism. They call it that. It's been named other things and it's already here and is a threat to us. Let's watch this next video.
This is the U.S. Army's concept of the soldier of the future. This video makes it look like it's just a better equipped soldier. But notice the words neural engineering. That can mean a brain implant that connects a human to computers. The defense agency DARPA has been working on an advanced implant that would essentially put the human brain online. There could also be eye and ear implants and more circuitry under the skin to make the ultimate fighting machine. Americans are going to have to decide whether this is ethical, because some in our military clearly want it. The super soldiers of the future could simply have enhanced abilities, or they could be part man and part machine, what are known as cyborgs. China is already developing biologically enhanced super soldiers, using what former Director of National Intelligence John Ratcliffe called unethical medical experiments.
This is a big effort on the part of the Chinese government, and it is really horrifying.
China expert Gordon Chang says it's part of a Chinese government plan to create a master race through genetic editing.
They're trying to create a race which is far more intelligent than the rest of humanity, and with super soldiers, they'd be stronger, less susceptible to pain, just better soldiers. This is eugenics. This is creepy. There are no ethical standards. There are no laws.
Now the French military has been given the go-ahead to also create so-called augmented soldiers. The super soldiers of the future will run fast, need little sleep, and little to eat or drink. And they'll be able to fight much longer than ordinary humans. But should we do it? George Lucas, who has taught military ethics to America's naval officers, says ethical concerns lag behind this new technology.
It always does. And the only question is how far.
And Lucas is concerned that future military recruits could be pressured to accept computer parts into their bodies. He believes they should be allowed to refuse them.
The further into these more exotic technologies we go, and the more the risks are not known, the more we must at least rely on volunteerism, if not as much informed consent as is possible.
But the challenge for the United States is, even if we put ethical limits on the super soldier of the future, it's likely some of our adversaries will not. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
How many know that God is greater? Oh, this could never happen. Pastor Chris, no, it's already happening. Don't be deceived. This is part of Satan's great reset. Can't you see it? God's design was to create a new race of human beings in who he could dwell and who he could work. Satan always has a counterfeit. He always has a counterfeit. This is part of Satan's great reset and a total counterfeit of what God has planned for our lives. Here's the danger. This would create a type of hybrid being that could and would be controlled by someone or something other than themselves. It would create a being that could not be redeemed because it no longer is a human being, nor think or decide on its own free will. That's the plan of Satan, church, to stop man at all costs from knowing God or ever being able to choose him and be saved. It is a plan to void man being in God's likeness and image anymore. That's what Satan hates. He hates man because he's in God's likeness and his image. You know, I don't have time to even talk about this today, but this is not the first time that something like this has happened. When we look back at Genesis chapter 6, have we ever remember where the sons of God came down to the daughters of men and cohabited with them and formed and created a race of giants? We don't like to even talk about those things, but all of that was Satan's plan to corrupt the human race, the human line through which Christ would come. That's why God had to judge the world, and only Noah and his seed were the only righteous line that were left on the earth so that the Messiah could still come through a righteous line. Now, I know that was a lot said in a short time, But you would say, why would I share these things today, Pastor Chris? Why would I talk about the Great Reset? Because number one, God has a Great Reset, and that's the reset that we need to know about. Amen. Number two, we need to know that whatever God has done, don't be deceived. That Satan is a counterfeiter, and he's going to try to counterfeit. And we are living in the last of the last days, and if you can't see, there's a great deception, a great delusion, that we're right before the second coming of Christ. And even back up a few moments, we're right before the rapture of the church. If you can't see it, you should see it. Why should I share these things, Pastor Chris? Because I'm telling you, don't drink the Kool-Aid. Don't take the bait and don't be fooled like the rest of the world. None of this is good and none of that is God. Don't be fooled by the language and by all the things the mainstream media would try to make you think that it's all right or it's just another thing. It all looks good. Why would I share these things? Because I echo the words of Jesus and his great warning to his disciples. In Matthew 24, verse 4, he says, take heed that no man deceive you. That was the very first thing that he said about the signs of the last days. Take heed that no man deceive you. And I can tell you the language, the technology, and all the things that have been happening in our earth today is a smokescreen behind an evil agenda and a godless plan. But I can tell you behind it, there is one greater, amen, other and all of that. I'll call Almighty God, and his plan is going to come to pass because we have read, all we have to do is read the end of the book. We know the dark is going to get darker, but the bright is going to get brighter. Why would I share these things? Because I, like Diedrich Bonhoeffer, in no means whatsoever do I preclude that myself equal to that great man of God. He said this, he couldn't open the eyes of the German church to the impending horrors of Hitler when Hitler did very similar things to this. Only at a level 100 years ago. Have we forgotten that they hung the Nazi officers and surgeons and doctors, many of them that were tried for acts of war, for experimenting on human beings and trying experiments that now today that we applaud like transgender operations and those kind of things. Those are the very things that those men were tried as criminals for. And today, we're like, that never happened. And have we forgot that that did happen? Diedrich Bonhoeffer couldn't open the eyes of the German church to the impending horrors of Hitler. His radio addresses warned Germany, but the church was lulled to sleep through cheap grace and blind submission. And today, if we're not careful, cheap grace, whatever will be, will be. And blind submission, like sheep headed to the slaughter. Oh, this couldn't be. That couldn't be. We just hide our head in the sand. I'm not telling that we have to study this and look at this, but I'm saying, wake up! Bonhoeffer said this. This is why I do this today. He said, silence in the face of evil is itself evil. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act. This is why I would share these things, so that we're not fooled along with the world. And I know this is disheartening for every young person and every old person. It makes the old person to feel like, I just want to give up and go home to be with Jesus. That is not the answer. Going home to be with Jesus is not the answer right now. We need you. And every young person to say, oh my God, I'm not going to have a future. I'm not going to have this. That is not the right thinking. And that's not the answer. But I'm going to give you the answer right here so that your hope in a future is according to the plan of God. Proverbs 27, verse 12, in the Passion Translation says, the scripture warns us, a wise, shrewd person discerns the danger ahead and prepares himself, but the naive simpleton never looks ahead and suffers the consequences. Remember, church, that God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, has called His church to be a restraining force to hold back these satanic agendas. He's called the church to be the restraining force through the power of the Holy Spirit. But it's going to have to be a spirit-filled church. It's not going to be a lukewarm church. It's not going to be a church that wonders whether I should come to church or not. It's not going to be a church that wonders if I should pray or if I should read my Bible or not. It's got to be a church that's on fire for God, that knows how to exercise authority for Jesus Christ and do the will of God. It all begins by us, the believer, knowing the truth, praying and acting on behalf of God. This is our call to action, church. This is our call to action. Knowing the truth, praying. Win the battle. The day that we prayed, the tide of the battle turned. Praying and then acting on behalf of God. That is our call to action. For the church, listen to what I'm getting ready to say. The world condition must be met by Christ's exalted position. Come on, this is the solution. For the world, to the world, if we're dealing with the world condition must be met with Christ's exalted position. In other words, we can say like this, the world condition must be met through our exalted position in Christ. If it doesn't, we don't change anything. If all we do is complain, if all we do is gripe, if all we do is talk about the problem instead of the answer, yes, we must know what's going on, but we must speak the answer. And we must meet this world's drastic condition by Christ's exalted position and our position in Him. Now let me leave you with two final verses that give us that call to action. In Proverbs 23, turn there with me. I'm going to read this from the Passion Translation. Proverbs 23, hallelujah, in verse 17 and verse 18. It says, don't allow the actions of evil men to cause you to burn with anger. Come on. Listen, I'm preaching, buddy. You're saying amen right now. What we just seen, this would cause us to burn with anger. Instead, and burn with an unrelenting passion as you worship God in holy awe. In other words, even this happened to Jesus Christ. I call it acting redemptively. You remember what Jesus did when he heard that John the Baptist got his head cut off? It says he left and went out and prayed, and then he came back and he healed multitudes. He went away and prayed. He acted redemptively. He didn't allow the actions of evil men to cause him to burn with anger, wherewith he's just mad at man. But what he did was, instead, he burned with unrelenting passion as his worship of God in holy awe or in the fear of God. That's what he did. And you and I, instead of going to get mad at everybody, we're going to have to get glad. We're going to have to be passionately burned with, we're going to have to burn with passion for the will of God and act redemptively. Notice what it says in verse 18. Your future is bright. Your future is bright and filled with a living hope that will never fade away. Your future is bright. Look at your neighbor and say, did you know your future is bright? Oh my God, Pastor Chris, all the stuff that you talked about today. No, your future is bright. Your future is bright. And filled with a living hope that will never fade away. Glory to God. I love it. So finally, this is the last call to action part that we're going to go right here. So I told you what we're going to do. Well, we're going to know the truth, God's word. Amen. We're going to pray. And then what are we going to do? We're going to act on behalf of God. That's our call to action. We're going to speak for God. We're going to act passionately instead of be mad and hot-headed about all the wickedness. What we're going to do is burn for God and a holy zeal. a holy fire for God. We're going to act redemptively. We're not going to let evil men and imposters make us mad and lose that joy. But instead, we're going to burn for God. Hallelujah. Now, Proverbs 24. Here's what an action plan is. Verse 11. I'm reading once again from the Passion Translation. It says, go and rescue the Persian. That's our answer. Be their savior. In other words, listen, I know that you're really nobody's savior, but in other words, represent Christ to them. That's what it's saying. Listen, I'm going to say it again. Go and rescue the Persian. Be their savior. Why would you stand back and watch them stagger to their death? And why would you say, but it's none of my business? The one who knows you completely and judges your every motive is also the keeper of your souls and not just yours. He sees through your excuses and holds you responsible for failing to help those whose lives are threatened. So in other words, why am I talking this way today? Because God has called us like never before. There's a lost and dying world. There's a harvest to be reaped before this church gets out of here. And that's our job. Come on, Brother Ryan, and help me in closing today. That's our job. Our job is to rescue the Persian. Go be somebody's savior. Go share the good news of Jesus Christ. Let the bad motivate us with the good. Let the evil motivate us with the good that we have. Understand that the world is going to hell in a handbasket, but it's our job to go rescue the Persian. It's our job to go care for the dying, to let them know that Jesus is merciful, that Jesus still saves. That is our action plan. And as a church, we disperse, not in anger against the world that's gone crazy, but in a passion for God and an unrelenting, awesome worship and fear of God, knowing that we're to go and proclaim God's goodness, His love, and His saving power to those that were just like us, lost and undone, that didn't know God, but someone shared the gospel. Someone prayed for us. Someone shared. We came to a church like this and heard the gospel, got saved. Someone met us in the parking lot somewhere. Someone talked to us at work. Someone did something with the gospel that helped us and changed us. And now it's our turn to go and do likewise. And God is counting on us in this last of the last days to be His voice and a force. Once again, not caught up in the evil, but understand that it's there and it's echoing how close we are, and not be fooled. Help people that are being fooled by what's going on in the world today. And the number one way is by getting them to Christ. Getting them to Christ. Father, today, bow your heads with me in closing. Father, I pray for the fire and the boldness of the Holy Ghost upon your church. Oh God, consume us each. Light us afresh, O God. May there be a fresh anointing. May there be fresh anointing and power upon the people of God. May you anoint them for such a time as this. May they be used, O God. May fear depart, and may boldness and confidence infiltrate them and fill them afresh with your spirit, so that the power of God flows through them and uses them in this day, in this hour. Uses them for your glory, Lord. Use us for your glory as individuals and as a church. Help us to understand that our best days are yet to come. That days full of glory, full of direction, oh God. Although the world is dark, our light, hallelujah, will shine, and that day will be bright, for the best is yet to come for us. We lay hold on the promises of God, and Father, it is our job, hallelujah, to rescue the Persian, to care for the dying. We thank you that Jesus, you're merciful. Jesus, you do save. Thank you that words will be spoken. Letters will be written. Things will be said. Things that are divinely inspired. And yet, you would even question, say, if the Spirit of God, could this really make a difference? But I will call to your remembrance that day that it will make a difference, saith the Spirit of God. how your prayers, how your actions, has those notes, those phone calls, that witnessing that I have led you to, and that one that I've led you to, or many, in many cases, you will see that yes, saith the Spirit of God, I led you to that place. And yes, it is not insignificant, but it will be used. So breathe prayers every day and cry out to me, dependent upon me, saith the Spirit of God, unto a church that needs you to be filled and to be refilled. Call out to me, saith the Spirit of God, for a fresh infilling and a fresh direction daily, and I will lead you into a way that you should go. And even places where you're at work and your mind is on your work and your duties and all those things, will suddenly opportunities will come, and there'll be like a switch that just happens, and boom, my Spirit will come upon you, saith the Spirit of God, and will prepare you and equip you to speak to people even in high places. Think it not strange, even as I told Saul of Tarsus, that I will put you in places, and I will use you in places, and I will use you in ways, and show you the things that you even must suffer for my name's sake, saith the Spirit of God. And there's songs to be sung, and there's children to be taught, and there's work to be done, and the Spirit of God says it must come, and there shall be fear no more, and there shall be laughing and joy, and there shall be singing, and there shall be a newness and a refreshing even now, saith the Spirit of God. For I will use you even again, as you thought I did little, but now I will even do much, saith the Spirit of God. And as the Spirit flows and the work of God is being done, then you will see, and there will be much rejoicing, and you will know it's me, saith the Spirit of God, because you will stay humble, and you will see it's me, and you will not be prideful or not be arrogant, but you will hear the voice of the Spirit of God say, this is the way, walk ye there in it. And you will make much glory and much praise of me, my son, saith the Spirit of God, and he will be glorified in your midst, and he will be praised, and you will be glad. Hallelujah! 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 We give you praise for it, Lord, today, in the name of Jesus. Now I pray, as heads are bowed, I pray that for you, and I declare it, I prophesy it, in the name of Jesus, it shall come to pass.